Good evening, everyone. I'm used to saying, and welcome to the John Kennedy School and the John Kennedy and John Kennedy Jr. Forum. This is a John F. Kennedy site, but we're just thrilled to be here. It's an enormous pleasure, an enormous honor. This, by the way, is made possible by the generosity of David Rubenstein, who is involved in both of these institutions.
Of course he is.
And we have a very, very fulfilling night. I'll have you know that this event, this morning event, we had 200 people who were unable to attend, were on the waiting list and so forth. Meanwhile, up at the Kennedy School right now, we have two heads of state speaking, the president of Colombia, who is, by the way, a Kennedy School graduate, as well as the prime minister of Norway. So it's never a dull moment, and we're thrilled to be a part of things, and we're especially glad to have all of those of you who are alumni and supporters and friends for what should be an extraordinary, extraordinary event tonight. As many of you know, we are in the early stages of launching a campaign. And the one thing I would just say about the Kennedy School and all of you is, this is a time when many people feel pretty discouraged. It's kind of particularly discouraging in this town right now, but a lot of other places. Two thoughts about that. First, the Kennedy School really does believe it's our mission to try and fix all that. Got a lot of work cut out for us. That's why we're doing it. And second, anytime you feel discouraged, come to the Kennedy School about this time of year and see all of you in your younger forms or in, so many others with their enthusiasm and optimism and the capacity to really change things. I'm fond of saying that everyone at the Kennedy School is there to make the world a better place. Everyone believes each of us can do something quite important. It's a naive notion, and so I'm proud to be the dean of one of the largest group of incredibly naive people in the world. So welcome to the naive few. All right, I want to just welcome a number of people here. Vicki Kennedy is here, and where are you, Vicki? I don't know where you are. There you are, right there. And many others, I think, and I guess I won't go through everyone. But I also want to thank Wendy Pagburn, who is our head of our alumni board, who's right here. She'll say a few words at the end. It has been an enormous pleasure to be a part of all of these things. It is an enormous pleasure. I've got the best job in the whole world. All right, here's one other test. You know a really big forum is there when an introducer introduces an introducer. And so this is one of those events. And so it's my great honor to introduce Trey Grayson, who is the head of the Institute of Politics. All of these forums and the forum at the Kennedy School and the forums on the road are really the result of the Institute of Politics, this extraordinary organization where Senator Kennedy was deeply involved, and Caroline Kennedy and her, as she was being confirmed, said she wants to be, yes, she's gonna be ambassador to Japan, but she still has to be involved at the Institute of Politics. It's an amazing, incredible place, as many of you know, and they put on, while we're putting a forum on here, we're entertaining two heads of state up in Cambridge. So Trey became the head of the Institute of Politics in January of 2011. Even as an undergraduate, he was deeply involved in the program, and he in fact became a member of the IOP Senior Advisory Committee. He's recognized as an expert on civic education, political beliefs of millennials. No one's ever accused me of being an expert on millennials, especially not my children. On civility in politics and governing, we'd like some help on that as well, and presidential primary election and voter registration reforms. He was formerly the youngest Secretary of State in the country in November 2003, when he became Secretary of State in Kentucky and served from 2004 and 2011. It's my very great honor to welcome Trey Grayson, great leader from the Institute of Politics.
Thanks, Dean Elwood. It's great to be back here at the Kennedy Center. My first official event as the director of the Institute of Politics back in 2011, and I actually hadn't even started yet, but they made me come back. We had a forum on the road. Some of you were probably here at the Kennedy Center, and we had a panel discussion with young American leaders talking about President Kennedy's legacy to service. And it's great to be back a couple years later, now that I'm fully ensconced as the director of the IOP. And as a living memorial to President Kennedy, what better place to have this forum on the road? I think I actually had the best job David, not you, but we can talk about that later, or we could talk about it here. We could have a forum on that. No, but it is great to be with all of you. For those who haven't figured this out yet, the forums are now all live streamed on the internet. Don't watch it now, because the President Santos from Colombia is speaking in the forum right now, so don't watch him, watch this. But when you get finished, you could turn in at 8 o'clock and watch the Prime Minister of Norway. But they're all live streamed, they're archived on YouTube, on iTunes U, and on our own website. So you can still participate in the forums, and we even take questions now via Twitter. The best questions submitted via Twitter, so you can get your questions still answered even from a distance. But it's great to be here, and I think it's also very appropriate to have the founding dean of the modern Kennedy School, Graham Allison, as our moderator for tonight's panel discussion on Syria. All of you know what Graham's vision and tireless efforts have meant to the success of the Kennedy School and Harvard as a whole. He's the Douglas Dillon Professor of Government at the Kennedy School and currently serves as the director of the Belfer Center for Science and International Affairs, and was respected by members of both parties and leaders all around the world. So please join me in welcoming Graham Allison to this forum on the road.
So good evening, I'm Graham Allison. I think if we're competing about the best job, I would say a former dean. hard to beat. Okay. In any case, welcome tonight to an extraordinary panel. The panelists, all of whom I've had the good fortune to count as friends for many years. One of the panelists knows everything, or almost everything. One has done almost everything, and one writes about almost everything. So that may be a slight exaggeration, but Jane Harman is a self-described escapee from the asylum on Capitol Hill, where she served 8 terms, the final 4 as a member of the House Intelligence Committee. She was a spouse of a legendary business entrepreneur, Sidney, where she learned many of the tricks of the trade in business. She was owner and publisher of Newsweek for a couple of years, where she became acquainted with the digital transformation that's disrupting news business as we know it. And now as head of the Woodrow Wilson Center here in DC, she's mastered the management of a think tank. There's many things to love Jane about, but one of them that I will cite is that she's author, among other things, of the proposed Harman rule that would limit any American president to bombing no more than 3 Muslim-majority countries at a time, and invading no more than 1 each term. So Mike Chertoff, Michael began life as a lawyer, graduate of Harvard Law School. He was a prosecutor in the U.S. Attorney General's office, later U.S. Attorney, where he investigated and prosecuted successfully cases of organized crime, political corruption, terrorism. He went on to be an assistant attorney general here in D.C. Then he was appointed to serve as a judge on the Third Circuit, then Secretary of Homeland Security. So he literally has done virtually everything in the space that we're talking about. He now heads a major consulting firm, the Chertoff Group, vice chairman of which is Mike Hayden, former head of NSA and CIA, and which gives companies and governments advice, among other things, about cybersecurity. David Sanger, my colleague and friend, is the chief Washington correspondent of the New York Times, a distinguished journalist who's won several Pulitzer Prize, author of the leading book on the Obama administration's national security policies called Confront and Conceal, that reveals, among other things, offensive cyber initiatives allegedly undertaken by the Obama administration under the label Olympic Games. He and I are also currently teaching, as we have over the last several years, a course at the Kennedy School right now called Central Challenges of American Foreign Policy, Strategy, and the Press. And a modular version of this is now up as Harvard Kennedy School's first MOOC. So if you go to HarvardX, you can sample this course It becomes live or live on the web October 1st. I should quickly add, though, that David is generally in favor of leaks and the publication of national security secrets. And I believe that leakers should be sent to jail, and I'm uncertain how best journalists who aid and abet them should be punished. So this is one of the dynamics of the course. So the topic tonight is certainly timely. The flurry of leaks and prosecutions has come so fast and furious that it would require full-time attention just to keep up with the names, the claims, and the allegations. Most of us can distinguish between Bradley Manning, at least that's what he was before, of WikiLeaks, and Snowden of NSA fame. But how many people here can distinguish between James Risen and James Rosen and the charges for which each is currently being investigated? For foreign policy reporters, leaked national security documents have become the equivalent of fires and murders for the local television news. If it leads, it bleeds. If it bleeds, it leads. The results have been a breathlessness in the publishing of secrets that leave the rest of us baffled. So under such conditions, not surprisingly, we revert to our priors or our prejudices, as you learned at the Kennedy School. Fear of government overreach on the one hand, if that's our main narrative, or alternatively, support for the government doing whatever it has to do to keep us safe from another 9/11 on the other. And too much of the TV debate is essentially shout TV. So tonight our panel will for sure demonstrate that it's not necessary to be disagreeable in order to significantly disagree. And indeed, I'm confident that the disagreements among the members of the panel will help illuminate for the rest of us some of the puzzles we have about what's actually going on and what's the impact of all these events and what should we do about it. So the game plan tonight is I'll start off as the inquisitor, try to put questions not too long, but I think the ones that many of us would be interested in to individual members of the panel, so no speeches. Try to get short answers. Where other members of the panel disagree, not where they agree, but where they disagree, you'll get a chance to comment. And we'll sort of go through the circle. And I want to start with the question of the accountability of the press. And maybe start with Michael, if that's okay. So Michael, in a 2011 Intelligence Squared debate, you said, quote, "There is a very strong presumption against publishing significant classified material. But there are cases where it happens. I believe, you say, the law allows, if the facts are there and the intent is there, a prosecution to take place as a way of deterring someone from publishing that secret," close quote. So my question, do you believe that the government should be doing more to prosecute journalists? And in particular, does the concept of a journalist as a co-conspirator or aider or abettor, which was initially the terms applied to Risen, make sense conceptually?
Well, I can't say that the government should be doing more to prosecute journalists because, to be honest, when I was head of the criminal division and part of my responsibility was to deal with leaks, we never would have dreamed of being as aggressive with respect to journalists as is currently the case. So the bar has moved way beyond where I was 10 years ago.
But appropriately in your view, or?
You know, I would say this. I can conceive of cases where journalists are technically guilty of a crime. For example, I don't know that, and I think there was a litigation about this in a case in Virginia, I don't know that merely publishing something that you know to be classified is a criminal offense. On the other hand, if a journalist were to go to a public official and pay him $1,000 to steal a secret, I have no doubt that's a crime. In many cases, you're in the middle, and it depends where, you know, how active the journalist is. But frankly, my view has pretty much always been the focus of the prosecution ought to be on the leaker, and that, except in the extraordinary case, it's really a sideshow and all kind of very problematic under the First Amendment to be going after a journalist, except in an extraordinary case.
Okay, and Jane, let me quote you on Meet the Press. This is in 2005, after the New York Times published a story on warrantless wiretapping. And you said, quote, "If the press was part of the process of delivering classified information, I think there should be some limits on press immunity," close quote. You still agree?
Well, let me back up for a minute. First of all, I'm delighted to see my former neighbor, Vicki Kennedy, here. We don't see you enough. It's lovely to have you here. Second of all, I miss Cambridge. I'm going there this weekend because it is the reunion or the celebration of 60 years of women at Harvard Law School.
Ta-da.
And I hope some of the, yeah. So I thought that'd be good.
So that's a Saturday event?
Friday and Saturday.
Friday and Saturday,
event,
yeah.
This week, right. On this question, I think, and I remember why I would have said that in 2005, and I think it is fairly well known. I spent 8 years on the House Intelligence Committee, and I was part of the so-called Gang of Eight. That's the chairman and ranking member of the Intelligence Committees, both sides, and the leader and minority leader, both sides, who are read into, briefed on the innermost intel secrets, or at least some of them, of our government. And I was briefed on the telephone metadata program before it leaked to the New York Times. And I did, in 2004, speak to the bureau chief of the New York Times, urging, they had the information by then, urging that they not publish it because I believed it would harm our national interest. When it was published a year later, I also learned at that time that the Bush administration had not been following the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act in the way it conducted the program, which was very horrifying. At any rate, I would say three things about this. First of all, the Fourth Estate matters. Our democracy depends on a free press, and we better be very careful about impinging on it. And there is a doctrine in the law called the slippery slope, so you really have to watch it. That's kind of one. Number two, there are secrets that, however they get to the press should not publish. In my experience, reporters, when talked to, are very careful about this. Most of them are. Number three, I see a difference between a David Sanger, that kind of a reporter, and an advocate who happens to write for a newspaper. I'm not going to name names. Those are not people who work for the New York Times. But there are some very irresponsible people out there who are call themselves reporters, but really what they are is a purveyor of information that they may be involved in getting from the government, not through a source, but directly. I don't know how they get it. But they are not, they're folks that I think are fair game. And if my comment wasn't that clear in 2005, I guess my views have evolved on this.
So, but just to not let you off the hook too carefully, either
you never
A
have.
Or B, A, I think there should be some limits on press immunity, that's A, or B, I think there should be no limits on press immunity.
Okay, I think that when reporters are really advocates disguised as reporters, they should not necessarily have immunity.
Okay.
That's what I think.
Good. So that takes us to David, though your characterization of him and mine might not be identical. But in any case, David. So let me describe to you a case. So it's 2010. This is an actual case. Someone contacts a State Department Korea official, Stephen Kim, and requests, quote, "what intelligence is picking up," close quote. And he then, the person who's contacted him, tutors Kim on a covert system for covertly emailing him this secret information. He says, quote, "one asterisk will mean contact me, and the previously suggested plans for communication are to proceed as agreed. Two asterisks means abort." That was the reporter for Fox News named James Rosen. How was his journalism distinguishable from espionage?
Good question, Graham, and I will turn to it as soon as I say, I just want to say how great it's been to be with the Kennedy School, working at Belfer, teaching with Graham. Graham always takes a very firm position that journalists like me, who publish at times classified information, should probably suffer, you know, jailing or worse. But he puts in an important caveat, which is that he only wants it done after all the grading of papers is finished, so that he's not stuck with the
pile. That are very high principle, yes.
It's also great to see so many friends, including many or several here who were from the Kennedy School and helped me with Confront and Conceal, and the book that Graham referred to, which was really, to a great degree, Kennedy School and Belfer Center product. Although, you know, at times probably Graham wonders whether that was a good idea. So, your question was, what's the difference between what reporters do and what spies do?
Well, it's specifically in that case.
And specifically in that case. And I think, Graham, what you're doing here is confusing some overly dramatic, I would say, techniques about how you're going to contact a source, and the fundamental question, which is, what happens when a source goes to a government official and tries to get some information? I think those techniques are probably a little bit overdramatic. I've been doing this work for 31 years. I've never yet met anybody in a parking garage for the purpose of handing anything off. I haven't moved plants from one side of our porch to the other. It's great in the movies. It's not really how it happens very often. Now, there are times when you call up a government official and say, as I think was happening in this case, is this set of events happening on the Korean Peninsula? Usually, you would do that after you already had done a fair bit of reporting from open sources. For example, when North Korea is getting ready to go do nuclear tests, I have delivered to my desktop most days, and when we think things are happening, commercial satellite photographs that are down to 1 meter resolution. And we farm those out to people who used to be photo interpreters for the government and are no longer, and say, here's an unclassified photograph that 10 years ago I'm sure would have been at that resolution, and give me a sense of what's happening. You're out talking to and interviewing any number of officials. And if you're writing about things like Korea's nuclear program, about Iran, about Syria and chemical weapons, it's almost impossible to do your job without tripping into areas that are classified somewhere, somehow. And usually, we don't even know what is classified and what isn't, because reporters don't have classification clearances. I don't know, in the case of Mr. Rosen, in the case you described, whether he knew, but I suspect, given the techniques, he must have, that this piece of information that he was trying to get was non-public in some form.
He was asking for the latest intelligence,
intelligence,
which was classified,
right,
which he received, it said.
That's right, and there's been a prosecution in this case. But I can tell you that in reporting on Korea and reporting on Iran, I have seen all kinds of disclosures. I've seen disclosures like the one that he's accused of, where somebody isn't authorized to discuss it. I've seen cases in which a member of the National Security Council was specifically authorized to divulge a piece of information, in this case to me, about movements that they were seeing in Korea because they wanted to have a story published that warned the North Koreans. But I didn't know from this person whether they were authorized or not at the time that they said it. I have seen cases where we have learned things from those open sources, including a story that we wrote 2 weeks ago about the North Koreans restarting their plutonium reactor. We learned this from open sources, but I can tell you every government official who discussed it knew that the material was classified in the channel they have seen, although in the channel we had it was open. So none of these cases are as easy as they seem on TV, where you hear everybody talking about he revealed a classified piece of data and another one, you know, and this is open and this is closed. Because most of the time, the reporting that you are getting, if you're doing your job right, is probably classified somewhere. And Graham, you've heard me say this before, but I had the distinct unpleasure of going through the 250,000 WikiLeaks documents that the Times published as part of a series called State's Secrets. I didn't read them all. We had a very good program that went through and sorted them through. But I would guess that about 15 or 20% of these classified documents were newspaper articles that had been published in Lisbon or Beijing or some other place that somebody stamped secret on, probably a Kennedy School graduate, put into the cable system, and it was sent back to Washington for someone to read. My point here, Graham, is you can't take the system seriously if so much is classified, and we've got to figure out a way in which you're really classifying secrets that are true secrets.
That part I agree with 100%, and I agree that it's extremely complicated. But what I was trying to do was to see whether there are any cases. I mean, otherwise, if I were giving advice to a foreign government, why would I not say, set up as a reporter, say what you're doing is investigative reporting, engage in all the tradecraft you engage in as a spy, and plead immunity.
And we have seen spies from foreign countries mock themselves up as reporters here.
Absolutely.
And in a previous era, I'm sure this never happened in Mike's time, we have seen the U.S. government send people out and disguise them as reporters. Actually, we've been
too.
Busy
but
discouraging
Michael, can you imagine the case, what's the distinction you're looking at as a prosecutor?
I mean, I think that the difference would likely be the motivation. It gets more complicated now because with the rise of blogging, it's not even clear what a journalist is anymore.
That's and absolutely
I, and
right.
I, actually, one of the things we did have to deal with when I was head of the criminal division was people claiming they had the right to have subpoenas resisted because they were journalists. And in this case, they may have had evidence. And their answer was, I'm a journalist because I'm writing a blog about something. And we say, well, that doesn't make you a journalist, and you don't get a journalist privilege that way. I can easily see a case where someone, if the motivation is specifically to help a foreign government, I don't think you're a journalist, even if you're sometimes employed as a journalist. So it's likely to turn on intent.
Yeah, Graham, can I
please
just add a couple things? One of the houses of Congress actually passed something recently related to a press shield law, and one of the things they struggled with was defining a journalist in the context of blogging, and I don't remember how it finally came out, but it seemed fairly reasonable, the definition, that is. On the classification systems, and there are many in the government, what David says is a conundrum. If you are briefed, I learned this in Congress, on something that is classified, you cannot discuss it, even if you read the same information in the newspaper in an unclassified form, not necessarily because it's leaked. There is rampant overclassification in our government.
For sure.
And it prevents people, if you think about it in real time, it prevents law enforcement, for example, if they don't have clearances, from getting certain information, because it can only be received by those with clearances. And when law enforcement reports things up the chain to Washington, sometimes that information gets classified. The intake is not classified. And then it creates the same problem on the other end. And efforts have been made, certainly I tried, to reduce overclassification. The only reason to classify material is to protect sources and methods. A good reason is not to protect turf or to protect yourself from embarrassment. And yet, sadly, the systems are abused, and it does make a mockery of this because I think the press is entitled to information that is not classified about systems and government practices. David is very good at getting this kind of information, and it gets very complicated if you are in the public sphere someplace and you actually think that and you know that information, but you're basically blocked from talking about it because you learned it in a different context.
Okay, let me go to the metadata collection by NSA, which has been so much discussed lately. So in August of 2013, the FISA court reauthorized the collection of metadata, and Judge Claire Egan's said that this was appropriate, in part noting that Congress has repeatedly voted to reauthorize this program after having numerous briefings on the subject. Senator Dianne Feinstein, chair of the Senate Intelligence Committee, has defended the NSA program to her liberal California constituents, and Nancy Pelosi the same, saying, quote, "It has been briefed to Congress, and the letters we have distributed, we've had long discussions, this has been argued on the floor. Mentioned in the article are two senators who've had concerns about it. Obviously, when there are senators that have concern, we discuss it, we debate it, but the vote was taken and the measure passed, and this continues." So my question was Congress appropriately briefed on this controversial law? You were there when it was first passed. So in Washington speak, what did you know and when did you know it?
Well, I told you, I was briefed on the original telephone metadata program as part of the Gang of Eight from 2003 through 2005. When the program leaked to the New York Times and an article was published, President Bush 43, in one of his Saturday conferences, partially declassified the program. He admitted there had been this program and explained it. That was the first time I could consult anybody outside. I couldn't talk to anybody about this. And yes, I'm a Harvard-educated lawyer, but no, I'm not an expert on the innards of how the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act works. At any rate, as soon as I could make a phone call, my one phone call was to a guy named Jeff Smith, who practices law in this town. I don't know if he went to Harvard, but he was former general counsel of the CIA. And he said, "Jane, you idiot, obviously the way they were running this program was outside of FISA." And that led to my statement that day that this is unacceptable. We have to put this program under FISA. And because FISA was passed in 1978 by a broad bipartisan margin in Congress during the Carter administration to correct the abuses of the Nixon administration, it sort of came out of the Church Report. It didn't then anticipate the era of cell phones and the technology we now have. So there were numerous legal issues involved in trying, it's too complicated to go into, but trying to make sure that this metadata program complied with FISA. So we had to amend FISA. We had a debate I'm trying to remember whether we had it in the Intelligence Committee. We certainly had a debate on the House floor, and I assume the Senate floor, when it passed the amendments in 2008, and we sunsetted them. So they have been reviewed and reauthorized twice. That's what this article is talking about. That's what Dianne Feinstein and Nancy Pelosi are talking about. Is this a perfect program? Of course not. Should there be a broader public debate? Yes. Should Congress micromanage this program? Oh my God, no, absolutely not. But should the oversight mechanisms be made more robust? Sure. Should there be maybe some kind of an ombudsperson in the FISA court to make sure civil liberties are not abused? That's fine with me. Should there be more transparency in terms of numbers of applications, numbers of approvals, this kind of stuff? Sure. But I basically feel that the conception of the program serves our interests in terms of providing a database against which we can go to make certain that some bad guy in a foreign land isn't directing a plot against us, which could include Americans, and which could result in the kind of thing that just happened in a shopping center in Nairobi.
So let me try to add a few things to illuminate this a little bit. First, let's be clear what we're talking about. We are talking about what in many cases people refer to as telephone billing records. The records in question are the number that from which the call is placed. This is all declassified now. I'm telling you stuff that's been declassified. And the number to which it's placed and the duration of the call. It does not include the name of the subscriber of either number. To get that, you'd have to go further. So it is billing records. Second, these records have been held by the Supreme Court over a period of decades to have minimal, if any, privacy under the Constitution. United States, Smith versus Maryland, a whole series of
in
cases.
In 1978.
Going all the way up to the present, including the FISA court. Third, why do we need this? In the period right before 9/11, the US government was appropriately up on a telephone in another part of the world, which was a known terrorist telephone. A call came in from somebody that was a relevant call. Because they were up on the phone overseas, they didn't know where the call was coming from. They didn't have the subscriber information. It turned out it came from Al-Midhar, one of the hijackers of 9/11, who happened to be in San Diego. If they'd been able to run that number overseas against the US database, they would have found the number was a US number. They would have found that person. That might have stopped 9/11. That is a concrete, absolute example of what this program does. Third, what did Congress know about it? Jane's taking you up to a certain point in time, and I don't want to debate whether the president is constrained with FISA when he's dealing with overseas communications. But it was brought under FISA. It was reauthorized in 2009 and 2011. I have seen members of Congress get up and say, well, we didn't know the program applied to this many records. I've seen the declassified letter, you can go on the DNI's website, that went to the Intelligence Committee that said, we want every member of Congress, 535, to read the description of the program we are enclosing. That description describes the metadata program as bulk collection. The words vast amount are used. The words large amount are used. There is no way a literate person who took the time to read that document would have been under any misapprehension of what this program was. And when members of Congress are briefed and they assent to things, and then later we hear they were not really in the room or they didn't really understand it, it not only discredits Congress, but it tells the people in the field who are risking their lives executing these programs, we don't have your back. We're going to send you out, and once you've done your job, we're going to stab you in the back. And that is a serious problem for our intelligence community across the board.
Okay, clear, clear. Let me go to you, David. So what evidence is there, if any, that NSA has deliberately abused its authorities? So if I read the press stories about this, which are breathless, they have two specific claims about NSA. The first one says, our spy agencies spy. Okay. The second second one says, our code-breaking agencies break encryptions. Duh. What am I missing?
Okay. So here's what you're missing. Everything that Jane and Mike just said is absolutely right. And I think it's worth asking the question about the metadata program. Why was this classified to begin with? Frankly, any terrorist who's been to the movies in the past 10 years would think that Mike was sitting in some classified room with all kinds of great screens and could go, you know, pull up a number really quickly. How many times have you sat and watched one of those shows, Mike, and said, boy, I really wish we could go
sure,
do that,
yeah,
right?
Okay. Yeah.
So that's number one. So there is an assumption out there that we have a capability that until a few years ago probably exceeded what our real capability was. So what changed with the NSA in the past 5 years? And on this, if you talk to people in the White House, if you talk to people on the group that is now reviewing these programs for the president, they'll basically give you an explanation as follows. Previously, we didn't collect the haystack because, frankly, we didn't have the computing power and we didn't have the algorithms to go find the needle if we had it. Over time, we developed that computing power. We developed those algorithms. We spent a huge amount of money doing so. And so we started collecting more and more and more haystacks, and it was probably legal under an interpretation of a 1978 law that, as Jane has explained, doesn't actually fit the technology that we're using, but that wouldn't be the first time that's ever happened in the law. What we didn't do was stop and have the public debate that says, as the president put it the other day, just because we can do this, does this mean we want to do this? Now, my guess is, in the post 9/11 period, using the example that Mike just gave us about one of the 9/11 hijackers, if the president had gone on TV and said, here's what happened, here's what we were failed to do, and therefore we need to do what we think we already have legal authority to go do, and just collect all of these billing records in one place, because it's not like the phone companies didn't have it. And in addition to the phone company have it, the government's going to have it. And we're going to be able to search it, and here are our protections for your privacy. My guess is that in the years after 9/11, that would have flown through Congress the same way the Patriot Act did. And so far, I haven't gotten anybody in the intelligence agencies to explain to me how that would have impeded their intelligence collection.
Okay. Good,
so that's one. Second point on the question of what else have we learned? Well, we have learned that there were some abuses, that the FISA court then turned around and stopped some programs.
That were reported to the FISA court.
That were reported to the FISA court.
That's a good thing, though. Right.
That's a good thing. Tells you the system works.
Right.
That has been disclosed, and the harm to national security from that disclosure now, I'm having a hard time seeing, so I don't know why it couldn't have been disclosed in real time. We know that there was a program that in which the U.S. government was going through a good percentage of American emails, not all emails, and that in 2011, the Obama administration halted this program because it was bloody expensive, and they weren't getting very much out of it. Okay? I think there is significant news value in the fact that the U.S. government had decided to go ahead and collect up a good number of Graham's emails. That one you sent on August 5th was really good. And I think it's interesting that we came to the determination as a government that this program was not worthwhile. And I think that there can be a middle ground here where that question is debated out in public. Now, there is a point at which the specificity gets so great that it would tip off an individual terrorist. And that's where the process kicks in that Jane described that is so important and that I fear is going to go away because of these investigations of press leaks. And that is a process in which a trusted reporter, probably not a blogger, goes to the government, as we did with WikiLeaks, as I certainly did, and I've said so with the Olympic Games thing, and said, here's what we're getting ready to publish. We know that much of this is classified. Let's sit down and talk about what would seriously do harm and not. And usually I have found that across administrations, Bush administration, Obama administration, before that the Clinton administration, people are willing to sit down and say, here's what we're really worried about. And as Jane has reported, most responsible journalists listen to that, and we find a way to publish the news that gives people a sense of what the government's doing without tipping off the terrorists and the sources and methods. That gets more difficult if you're defining journalists as broadly as bloggers and anybody who sits down in front of the keyboard.
But David, just one correction. The government does not have a right to read the emails of Americans absent an individualized warrant, which is secured through the FISA court.
I didn't say they read them. I said they collected them.
Well, but what happened in that interim period between 2009 and 2011 is that the way emails come up, and you know, again, my kids would be laughing at me right now, saying, "Mom, you're so hopeless." But in getting emails that they had lawful permission to get, embedded in those emails were other emails from and to Americans, and they were collecting those as well, and that was uncovered by the FISA court, and all of that has been purged since because it was an overbroad interpretation of the law or an unfortunate technological problem.
And there's some evidence that the NSA was not fully forthcoming with the court about all of those
details.
Well,
I think they were. I think they have a problem communicating in simple English. Keith Alexander is really good at this, but others who are much more technical have trouble explaining this, but I think the press description of the program, that's why I raised it, was not accurate, and it made it sound much scarier than it was.
I think there's two takeaways there. One is, I do agree with Jane. I mean, and initially, the reporting about all of the activities of the FISA court was, oh, it's a rubber stamp. Yeah. And then we come to find out in the next wave of stories that actually they're quite vigorous at wrapping the knuckles of the government, even for inadvertent mistakes, which I think, as Jane says, is a good story. I agree with Graham. I think as you read the legal documents, which have been redacted, but they're, you know, posted, I wonder whether we couldn't declassify more of the legal documents and have more of a discussion at a high level. There is no question a tendency to take the logic of classification to an extreme, and sometimes a failure to understand that there's a programmatic cost to overclassification that has to be weighed against the, you know, specific cost of sources and methods, and sometimes you lose more than you gain. So we do have to revisit
okay.
that.
I think those are two good takeaways, and I mean, we haven't concluded this. The debate about NSA will continue for a long time. Very shortly, I'm going to come to the audience so you can be thinking of even harder questions. Easy questions we don't want. Let me take you to Snowden for a minute. So there's a poll in August asking Americans, what do they think about Snowden? And they gave them a couple of choices. Traitor, and the other one was whistleblower. Before I tell you what Americans thought, you have to choose one of those. Which one?
You asking me? He was not a whistleblower. He had plenty of ways he could have blown the whistle through legal channels. And oh, by the way, Mark Udall and Ron Wyden inside of Congress on the Intelligence Committee, who were very troubled by this program, used all the appropriate channels to blow whistles. And I commend them for expressing dissent in a proper way. So he wasn't a whistleblower. Calling him a traitor when he's under indictment and hasn't been tried is something I'm not going to do because he's entitled to a fair trial. But do I have any sympathy for this guy? Absolutely not. And I think his choice of Hong Kong as a destination after Hawaii, after he'd inhaled this material through thumb drives, by the way, it's still a classified number, I believe, how much he took, but I am sure it's okay to say it was a vast amount of material. My view is he ends up in Hong Kong, which is part of China, and if China hasn't fully exploited the information, Russia surely has. And I think he has caused and will cause, as we learn more about what he has, not just related to these programs, massive harm to U.S. security.
Okay. And you could be absolutely sure, again, without any classified facts, that his computers and hard drives were downloaded within a second, both upon arrival in China and in arrival in Russia. Mike?
the phrase that comes to mind goes back to the Cold War. I think it was Gene Kirkpatrick who used to refer to people as useful idiots. They were basically, useful idiots were basically naive individuals who were exploited by the then Soviet Union to take positions that advanced the Soviet agenda, you know, because they were duped or because they were too foolish to understand what they were doing. Now, maybe that's giving him more credit than he's entitled to. Certainly not a whistleblower, because he really didn't expose wrongdoing, let alone go through channels. Traitor, I mean, I guess we'll leave that to a court case, but nothing to be admired, and I think his embracing Russia as a great place where you have civil liberties. You know how they deal with journalists there who leak things is they either wind up with radioactive material in their veins, or they get arrested and they somehow have problems in jail and never make it out alive. So I wouldn't, you know, hold Putin's Russia up as a model of how we ought to be dealing with journalists.
Okay, David, what's your category for it?
So, treason's defined in the Constitution, whether that's what he did, I don't know. Violate the oaths that he had to protect classified information, based on his own statements, seems very clear that he did that. Did he do harm to the United States? I think it's fair to conclude that in a number of America's international relations, certainly as we've seen with the Brazilians, he probably did some harm.
Yeah.
Usually I find that the claims of harm that one hears right after a leak are a little bit inflated compared to what we think later on. I mean, in WikiLeaks, you would have thought the world ended the day that that all began to be published by the Times, and it was Bob Gates who sort of said, you know, in the end, people are going to talk to the United States again because we're the United States, and lo and behold, 6 months later, they did. So I'm not sure how much damage was done there. Whatever you think of Snowden, whether you think he is a traitor, whether you think he's a whistleblower, whether you think he violated his oaths, I think that incidentally, he started a useful debate in the United States on a number of these issues that, as the president himself said, we needed to have.
Right.
Now, why the president didn't say that before Snowden revealed all of this and start up that debate is up for all of you to conclude. But it's the same language that we heard about drones, the least covert program in America. Okay, every time there's an attack, it shows up on Pakistani TV and then in Long War Journal and eventually in the New York Times. Okay, so why this program is covert, I don't know. But it took years of heavy-duty investigative reporting to force the government of the United States to come to terms with what the rules were about drone attacks. And at some point, the president gave a speech earlier this year in which he said we needed to have this debate. I would respectfully submit that without a press reporting on classified data, we wouldn't have had that debate. And now, we're in the point of having to do that about cyber war as well. We have a case where the United States and Israel used cyber weapons against another state.
Allegedly.
Allegedly, if you're Graham, right? I think the evidence is pretty good. And in this case, we're beginning to see a debate, which the government is not yet participating in, on the question of whether or not we want to use cyber weapons, since the United States is the country that is most vulnerable to the use of cyber weapons against us. That's a debate the president discussed with his aides in the Situation Room. And it's one that you're now beginning to see happen. And my guess is, over the next year, you're probably going to hear much more vigorously. And at some point, some politician's going to step up and say, that's a debate we needed to have. I think they're right. I think without a free press, that isn't going to happen.
Okay. Well, we're not going to say that we shouldn't have a free press. I'm not going to say that. But let me just tell you what the August Quinnipiac poll said. 34% of Americans think Snowden is a traitor. 55% of Americans think he's a whistleblower.
Yeah.
That's different than the Washington consensus, I would say.
I suspect it is, but as often the case, there's a big gap between Washington and America.
Yeah, and also, to be fair, I mean, as you all know when you deal with polls, how you phrase the question and whether people even understand what a whistleblower is, it is really complicated, so I don't put a lot of weight.
But it also belies his claim that he can't get a fair trial in America. He does have a lot of sympathy, and I do think that the debate that has emerged, which we could have had years ago, is a useful debate. And just one amendment to what David said, John Brennan, when he was the counterterrorism advisor in the White House, asked to come over to the Wilson Center, which he did, and talk about the drone program. He's the one who first revealed it and what the legal limits around it are and should be, and that's still a work in progress.
That's absolutely right, but do you think that he would have done that had it not been for a lot of reporting in a lot of different places raising many questions about
the drone program? Know, but I think it's commendable that he did do it, and I do agree with you. I think we're all agreeing that a lot more about these programs should be debated and should be public.
One of the things that the Institute of Politics does is polls of college students and younger people. And if you look at this on traitor versus whistleblower and take the population 18 to 29, the government has lost this case completely. Completely.
Well,
so more than 70% of the people.
But expectations of privacy by younger people are completely different. I mean, how many of you have kids who put stuff that you can't imagine on their Facebook pages? I don't have a Facebook page and I don't read my kids, but I know they do it. And then they, you know, you compound it with all the other technologies, and they're okay with this. And oh, by the way, forget about the government. Google, which is on the cover of Time magazine this week, knows much more about you than even than the government does, and can access your location. And your credit card companies know if you bought a pair of sneakers in Cincinnati and you weren't supposed to be there. So let's kiss it off in the public space, even in terms of our activities on the web. There are folks out there who have information on what you're doing.
So, Jane, you're leading to my last question and then we're up to the public. So, a Harvard College graduate, Scott McNeely, who was the founder of Sun Microsystems, one of the early big internet companies, said famously back in the 80s, quote, "You have zero privacy anyway. Get over it."
I think I just said that.
You did. So this was well before supercomputers were measuring their speed in petabytes, or the era of what we call big data. So as we think about the technology and the reality of Google and otherwise, is Scott more right or more wrong?
You know, I think it depends a lot on what you mean by privacy, which is a term we use to cover a lot of different things, and I think we need to unpack it. I would say 2 points. First, I would echo what Jane says. Things that we used to think of as private, a number of people now put out in the open, and that's they may not fully understand the implications of that. But the second big change is that what is made of things that are public and have always been public is different now than it was 20 years ago. 20 years ago, you know, if you were out on the street, it was public, and if you did things or said things publicly, or if you spoke in a crowd like this, it was public. But we all kind of assumed that not that many people would see it, not that many people would remember it, and not that many people would be able to collect it. There was what I call friction in the public space. And that functionally created kind of a gray zone between privacy and total knowledge and awareness all over the world. The rise of data analytics, coupled with the ubiquity of sensory equipment out in the public sphere, not in your home, means now that it is possible, if according to a particular company, if everybody wore a set of glasses, they could continuously photograph everybody else. It would then be uploaded to a giant cloud where all the data would be there, and that company could then literally map what you do every single minute of the day in the public space, not relying on George Orwell's government telescreens, but on everybody being everybody else's big brother. Now, is that private? No, because it occurred in public. Is it vastly different than the expectations that we've had about what is done with public behavior? Vastly different. We have not come to grips with the data revolution.
And it gets worse. If the FAA does allow airspace for drones over the U.S., drones for law enforcement purposes and also owned by private companies, and if drones acquire new capabilities, and I predict they will become very capable, using infrared, they might be able to see in your house. Just dwelling quietly over your backyard, they'll see in your backyard. They might be able to hear you, and we've just shredded the Fourth Amendment. So we have a lot to discuss, and I personally think the FAA should not be the only regulating body about the use of drones over the U.S. I think, personally, we ought to think long and hard before we let any of that happen.
You mean you're going to restrict the drone that I use for watching David?
That's it.
Yeah.
But you don't really even need a drone for that because, you know, Google Earth will do a pretty good job.
Absolutely.
By the way, you have to mow your lawn. The difficulty I think that we are coming into here is that we are very unhappy about some things that the government is collecting where we haven't decided what we think about the fact that private companies do it.
Right.
So why was the government collecting all of this telephone data? Well, Verizon and AT&T had it for years, right? The only reason the government wanted to go off and collect it was A, to have it in one place, and B, because Verizon and AT&T didn't want to hold on to it and was going to destroy it. But we're in an era when, because of your smartphone, you know, we've got supermarkets that are following your buying habits and where you walk down each aisle, right? You've got cameras around London and now downtown New York that will do a lot of the facial recognition that Mike just described. And so in this era when the government can get this data from private industry as easily as we have seen through the FISA court, I think we have to have a new debate that says, first, do we want to make a distinction anymore between private company collection and government collection? And then secondly, do we want to put limits on what the government itself can obtain from private industry along those lines?
But third, what do we say to, if private industry can collect and hold all the data, do they have no restraint? In other words, the government, which collects far less, can't use it to save your life, but company X, which collects far more, can use it to sell
you
things.
Yep.
Absolutely.
Or maybe they decide they don't like your views on something,
yeah,
and they use it in some way to embarrass you. So I think one of the challenges you have now is a real asymmetry in which, for the first time, the government's capability to collect is at least rivaled by the private sector, but the level of restraint on the government is much greater.
Remember the quaint days when we argued about whether or not a library had to turn over the records of what you borrowed? And now you go on Amazon and it says, David Sanger, based on your buying patterns, you want to read Graham Allison's Essence of Decision. Yeah.
Good. 50 cents.
That's I had to read it 30 years ago.
Let me get, there's microphones on the floor here and here. The procedures at the forum, for those of you who remember, and plus there's a microphone in back if you raise your hand, is to introduce yourself, and as David Elwood always reminds us, a question is brief and ends with a question mark, so please.
I'm Alan Rawlware at Sidley Austin. After the Snowden leaks, our European trading partners and most recently Brazil have been shocked that our spying agencies are engaged in spying. We know that with regard to the incidental accumulation of information about innocent Americans, as Ms. Harman said, you know, you need a particularized order or warrant to access American information. And if the government picks it up incidentally, there are certain minimization practices
right.
that are really quite rigorous to prevent the information of innocent Americans being analyzed, shared, and so on. In order to allay the concerns of our European and other trading partners who are denying our internet companies, you know, billions and billions of dollars a year of cloud and other services, would it behoove the United States as a matter of policy, not a constitutional requirement, but a policy, to say to our international friends that we're going to protect the data of their innocent citizens according to, you know, the same data minimization practices and maybe give them protection under our Privacy Act, which foreign citizens don't currently have, simply because we're good citizens of the world, we want to continue doing business with our European and other friends, and just because we're not interested in the communications of innocent foreigners.
Does any of you have an
opinion? I mean, you know, I went through an iteration of this about our collection of data with respect to travelers, very, you know, kind of benign data. The financial system went through this with SWIFT. You know, there's something to be said for the argument that for really innocent communications, we will minimize it. But part of the challenge is, though, sometimes you need
right.
to keep the data for a period of time because the relevance of it becomes relevant only a period of time, over a period of time. Secondly, I'm not aware of any foreign country that reciprocates or has a rule like that. I don't know that of any European country, for example. Many of them don't require even a warrant. So I'm not sure there's a symmetry here. But I think we'll probably wind up having some kind of a discussion about some kind of a process going forward.
Yeah, my answer would please David. I actually think there ought to be a private discussion among leaders, and I'm sure that's going on. But I think what you're suggesting is very difficult to even conceptualize. And oh, by the way, there are bad guys hiding out in countries we like, and we have found them, including our own country. So I think it's very difficult to conceptualize that kind of rule. Also, what's going on here is elected leaders have to stand for re-election. These programs are highly unpopular, so they're all shocked, and oh my God, let's postpone the state dinner. But then at another level, there is still ongoing cooperation. And one of the points that I think Jim Clapper made or Keith Alexander made is this highly unpopular program has helped foil plots in Europe as well as the United States, and yet leaders in Europe are all blasting us for having the program.
Dave?
Let's make the problem harder. We're told that the government minimizes the data about individual U.S. persons under rules that FISA set up.
Right.
And then one of the documents that came out of the Snowden archive was a memorandum of understanding between the NSA and its equivalent in Israel, the Signal Intelligence Unit, also known as Unit 8200. And that document, just based on, and it's just a memorandum of sort of what they would go do, says on its first page that the NSA will share with this foreign government raw intel that is not yet minimized. And we would appreciate it if the Israelis, if they run across information about US persons, would follow the same rules that the FISA court has set for us here. But there's no way of enforcing this. This hasn't gotten enough discussion yet, but it is an interesting issue. And it's an issue that we wouldn't be debating had it not been for the Snowden release. And again, I'm not apologizing for Snowden and what he went and did. But if, in fact, we are getting around the FISA rules by handing foreign governments, and I suspect the Israelis are not the only ones, raw data, and then saying it would be very nice if you minimize this, we probably have an issue to debate.
Okay.
I agree.
Gentlemen.
Yes, thank you. I have a question for the panel.
Please introduce yourself.
Oh, my mistake. My name is Garrett Harkins, and I graduated from the MPP program in May, actually. So I have a question about the comparison that's been drawn by some of the panel members tonight and also some members of the press, which is this idea that Google and Facebook and Apple have all this information, so why is it so bad the government does? And I guess my thought on that would be that when you sign up for Google or Apple or Facebook, you sign a terms of agreement, and I guess the equivalent for a U.S. citizen would be the Constitution, your terms of agreement to live in this country. So I guess my question is, how does saying that one organization can have your information based on the services they provide entitle another organization that doesn't have that same, for example, terms of agreement to that same information?
So here's my answer to that. First, I'll assume for the sake of argument that people actually read the terms of agreement, which is debatable.
Well, you agree with them anyway. So.
Everyone here who did raise their hand.
Let's say something different. Let's say you're on Gmail. I'm not. I respond to your email. I haven't consented to Google's terms and conditions, but that data is now in their file. Supposing you walk around with your camera or your Google glasses, you take a picture of me, you upload it to the cloud. I didn't consent to that. Now they have it in the cloud. Let's say everybody here over the next hour takes pictures of me walking around, and it's uploaded to the cloud, and Google can now say, well, this is where Michael was for this whole hour. I haven't consented to that. How does that work?
Thank you.
Okay.
Let's. You want to make a quick response?
Nope. Thank you.
Good. This gentleman here.
So my name is Zachary Rosenfeld. I also graduated as an MPP in May, and I actually wanted to sort of expand on what Mr. Chertoff and Ms. Harman were discussing about proper channels for whistleblowing and leaking. I think what's something that's striking to me about both Chelsea Manning and Ed Snowden is that they seem to have a really profound distrust in the system, both in the government and in the press. They didn't leak to the Washington Post or the New York Times. They leaked to the Guardian and to WikiLeaks. So I guess my first question would be, why do you think this is? Is this something about their generation or a lack of knowledge and what their rights or what the proper channels are? And second, how would you encourage future leakers or whistleblowers to follow the proper channels or to at least leak to the Washington Post or the New York Times?
I can answer part of that. As Mr. Snowden explained, he thought the New York Times encryption system was insufficiently robust, that he needed to find somebody who was more robust. The fact that he went to somebody who had pretty good privacy as well makes one think he probably was quite confused.
Well, he was certainly right about the quality of our encryption system, because as we know now, a Chinese group of hackers made their way inside the New York Times computer system for about a month and a half before they were exercised. And
before
I have to
you
actually,
discovered it.
Yes. What's that?
Before you discovered it.
And I have to actually admire these guys, because I've been working there for a little more than 30 years, and they understood how to get around the computer system better than I've figured out in all that time. but you know, you raise a really interesting question, which is, if you sit here with this panel, they're all saying, why is the New York Times and the Washington Post, and then even worse, WikiLeaks or Anonymous or something like that, publishing government secrets? If you ask the people on the other side of this, or foreign governments, they all think that we're published through a publishing system that runs through the CIA. okay?
Right.
So it's a complete mismatch of view. And I think that, you know, Snowden was quite clear that one of the things that he did not like about the New York Times was that during WikiLeaks, we went and had a conversation with the government about what would be truly damaging. Now, I'm glad we had that conversation. Graham's heard me use this anecdote before. We can say it now. We couldn't say it then. Before we published some of the documents on Libya, which we had emailed over to government officials in the State Department and said, look, we're getting ready to do a big piece on Libya, I got a call from a very senior official who said, look, David, I didn't know this until an hour ago, but there's a guy named in one of these documents who's been an asset of the United States reporting on Gaddafi for years on end. And while the document doesn't report that he was an asset, if Gaddafi sees his name in this cable, he's just going to turn around and shoot him. Okay? Well, a few years later, as far as we know, this guy's still walking around and Gaddafi has run into some other issues. But what we do know from this is
You excised this piece.
We excised it right away.
Yeah.
Okay? And we excised not only the names of dissidents who were going in to the Chinese embassy, but the times at which they were doing it. So the Chinese wouldn't match it up with their cameras that are focused on all of the entrances and exits to the Chinese embassy. So we were pretty careful. It was that care, I think, that Snowden was complaining about and one of the reasons he didn't leak to us. Well, that's life. I'd rather be careful, but also still try to get the big policy issues
You're to be commended for being careful. I hope I said that at the front end. But why didn't Snowden, if he disapproved, first of all, I'm sure every place he worked, there were appropriate places to express his opposition. Second of all, he could have quit. He joined a government agency, a series of them and contractors, and signed oaths to protect the secrets that he was entrusted to learn. He was one of a small group of these systems analysts. Clearly, we have to do better vetting people and re-vetting people, and we have to impose, which we now have, the two-person rule, so these people are watched by each other. And I don't find anything objectionable about that, working in those conditions. You sign up to, you know, basically do this kind of work, you ought to be supervised extremely carefully. But he didn't do any of that. He set out to inflict maximum harm on the agencies in which he worked, and using thumb drives, which was illegal, to suck out as much information as possible. And I don't know how much of this he really understood, but he then went to two governments that we should assume have fully exploited the information he had. And again, we can't discuss what all that information is, but there's a lot more out there that I have been briefed on this, that I think, if it comes out, will be enormously harmful to us. And so I don't have any sympathy whatsoever for him, and I do have sympathy for whistleblowers who use proper channels, which are set up, and they are protected if they use them.
This gentleman.
Great. My name is Mark Zaid. Unfortunately, no affiliation with Harvard. I'll happily go if they'll take me in.
You'll be welcome.
But I am a national security attorney here in D.C., and by way of background, I was Jeff Sterling's lawyer, who Jeff is being prosecuted in the Eastern District of Virginia for allegedly leaking information to Jim Risen, David's colleague. I was Bill Leonard's lawyer, who was the former secrecy czar of the United States as a defense witness in the AIPAC prosecution. I was the journalist A's lawyer in John Kiriakou's prosecution, and in fact used to be John Kiriakou's lawyer when he was first accused of leaking classified information. I'm sort of following up on the question that just came about, because the problem is, and I'll say, I'm no fan of Snowden or Manning, and I hope they're both well. Obviously, Manning's been prosecuted and sentenced. I hope Snowden one day is as well, because they didn't follow the system. But those of my clients who are national security whistleblowers who do try to follow the system do not find any meaningful or legitimate redress during the course of their attempts to go through channels, whether chain of command, officer inspector general, the intelligence committees. Part of the problem is they get no feedback back from any of these entities that is able to allay their concerns, so that, as Snowden said in following the Drake case, who did try to go through channels, he reported these issues, whatever they might be, and then all he would get back was, no, don't worry about it, it's fine. without any explanation of, well, maybe you don't know this because it's been compartmentalized and you didn't have any need to know beforehand. So to kind of drill down just a little bit more on the question, you know, as a member, former member of HPSI, as a former secretary of one of the largest departments of the United States, you know, do you have any sense or ideas from your own experiences of what could be done to better enhance the system for legitimate whistleblowers? And a little bit more on the HPSI question, do you see, having served there for the 8 years I think you were, do you see a possibility that other oversight committees that clearly have overlapping jurisdiction over the Intelligence Committee but are not allowed to exercise that jurisdiction, whether perhaps they should be able to? Government reform, judiciary, armed services?
Good. Good question. Tough question.
Well, Michael can answer maybe about the government whistleblower rules, but in Congress, I was always interested when people would come in and talk about what they thought were abuses. And to the extent, I just speaking for me, thought that these claims should be followed up, we did that. And we reported them places and we tried to take action. I'm not going to reveal any specific cases, but we cared about that. In terms of overlapping jurisdiction, there is some overlapping jurisdiction. And the Judiciary Committee, for example, has not identical, why would two committees have identical jurisdiction? But Pat Leahy is out and about talking about limits on NSA's authority, and he has jurisdiction behind him. And whether his ideas pass or not, he's holding hearings along with Dianne Feinstein, as she's the chairman of the CISI, of the Senate Intelligence Committee. And I think more members of Congress are in this game. And also the briefings about these programs now are classified, but they're to every single member of Congress. Some members are not going to the briefings. You should know that. They choose not to because they would much rather talk publicly about the programs. And if they've been briefed, they feel they'll be muzzled. But, you know, I think it's fair to say they don't want all the facts to get in the way. That may not be totally fair. But
Jane, that
applies.
Congress,
that's not a partisan rant. Yeah. In some ways, some parts of Congress are a fact-free zone. I'll say it.
Okay, Michael, I
don't know anything about the cases you've been representing people in. My experience in general is that when people have issues like that, they raise it to the Inspector General or some similar internal agency office. It does get taken seriously. Now, sometimes what happens is the whistleblower, you know, the IG the authority who makes the final decision just disagrees with them. People sometimes have an idea of what the Constitution requires of the law, and they're wrong. And you've got to be, once it's presented and, you know, people have said, well, we've determined there's nothing wrong here, you've got to accept it. Otherwise, you're taking the law into your own hands. And I think that's what we've seen in a number of cases.
Okay. They're telling me that we need to end, so you get the last question. A brief question and maybe brief answers. Yes?
Hi, I'm Alex Remington. I just graduated from the Kennedy School. I took your class. I'm also a product manager of the Washington Post, but this question is in my capacity as a Kennedy School grad. I heard the four of you, I believe, express some feeling that bloggers somehow should be determined as not being afforded the full protection, the constitutional freedom of the press. If there is a shield law that's being debated, or if we are determining what it is protected to publish, then some people should be afforded these protections and others should not. Speaking of some of the cases that we've mentioned, some of the Snowden articles, of course, were published in the Washington Post. The person who published them, the two people were Barton Gellman, a former Post reporter, and an independent documentarian. Glenn Greenwald, whom I believe you alluded to earlier, Madam Harman, is a blogger, but employed by a newspaper, not in this country. So these are difficult to classify roles, but I'd like to understand some kind of intellectual framework. Where do we give our protections? How do we determine what's legitimate? Because it seems to me that these are acts of journalism being committed, however we define the people who are committing them.
I didn't mention either of those reporters, by the way. What I did say is that when, I think it was the Senate, was debating the latest version of the press shield law, which either was reported from committee or passed on the Senate floor, on the floor of one of the houses, it tried to define what a journalist is and tried to come up with a definition for when a blogger is a journalist. And that I don't recall exactly what the definition was, but I thought it was a pretty responsible attempt to define when a blogger is a journalist. And no one has said, certainly I wasn't saying, that blogging should be treated differently from other forms of journalism.
I would separate two things out. Every American, whether you're a journalist or blogging or just talking to your neighbor, you all have freedom of speech. So you don't get punished for speech. The issue with journalists is they ask for special protection, something that nobody else gets. And it came up, at least in my experience, in the context of shield laws, where somebody has information that's relevant to an investigation and they don't want to turn it over because they say they're a journalist and they acquired it in the course of trying to prepare a story. And that's where the issue of blogging becomes a problem. Supposing someone once a month writes a blog about gardening and things of that sort, and then they want to say, well, you know, I got this information, or I witnessed this, and I don't want to talk about it because I was going to use it in my gardening blog. Does that person get a press shield? As long as you're asking for special privileges, you're going to have to find a way to define it. And actually, more broadly you define the encompassed class, the more you're going to dilute the privilege for the kind of hardcore case that people actually probably think about when they talk about a press shield.
Alex, it's a very good question, and it's good to see you again. The difficulty here is you don't want to be in a position where the government begins defining who's a journalist. That's the reason journalists aren't licensed. It's the reason journalists aren't a profession. Don't tell my mother. So the problem in the definition, I haven't seen yet what came out of that legislation, is at the moment that you get the government beginning to define it, you begin to get a lot like a lot of societies we've seen that have identified who are journalists for very political reasons for the government itself. I'm not accusing the US government of trying to go do that, but I think it's a road we don't want to go down for First Amendment purposes. But Mike is exactly right. The only reason this issue comes up is the question of, is there some kind of special protection, mostly against having to testify against who your sources are. Now, this would be a really great problem to have if the courts were recognizing much of a protection for journalists about not having to testify. But in fact, in the Jim Risen case, we just saw out of Virginia, a court ruling that said that essentially there's no real protection in the end. And I'd rather sort of focus the debate there first about whether or not there should be a privilege. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a very reasonable debate to have. The late Tony Lewis, columnist for the New York Times, spent a lot of time at Harvard Law School and around the Harvard campus, made an argument that there was no special protection for journalists. And I think has laid out probably the best intellectual case for that argument. I don't fully buy it, but the best one that's out there. If we came to the conclusion that there really wasn't a special protection, then the question of who is a journalist and who isn't probably goes away. Right. At the moment that we begin to define some boundaries, then it becomes a hard problem.
Okay. I'm very sorry to bring this conversation to a conclusion. I said that I thought we were confident that we would have substantial disagreements, but that they would not be done in a disagreeable manner, and I think that's certainly right, and that it would be illuminating. And I think actually we've all learned a lot in this process. So I want to turn now to Wendy Penburn, who's the chair of the alumni board, and she's going to close the program.
There we go. I may get you in a little trouble, but I think there's still a lot of questions that people would like to maybe continue this dialogue. So I don't know if it's all right with you, but maybe continue to send the questions to your blog or something like that. Perfect. Email to Trey. First of all, thank you very much to the audience for being here. This is a sold-out crowd tonight, and we're thrilled on behalf of at least the DC Network to have everybody here. And also a special thanks to our distinguished panel. On On behalf of the Harvard Alumni Association, I wanted to share a couple little fun facts with you. First of all, believe it or not, our Alumni Association is over 50,000 people, and we're in over 200 countries, which I think is a pretty amazing and staggering number. So we're a big group to be reckoned with. The second thing I wanted to share was right now we have our international board is 20 people. Some of them are here tonight. I'm going to ask them to stand in a minute. And these folks put a lot of time and energy to diligently work on behalf of the school. And we also have now 25 networks around the world. And these are both regionally based and they're also interest-based. So there's a way to stay further connected to the organization. And my sort of advertisement or commercial tonight is on how to stay involved. So there's sort of six quick things I'd like to mention. The first is the class notes. Easy thing, you know, let the school know when you've gotten promoted or you've gotten elected or you're published or you're in the news, hopefully in a good way. But let the school know about that. And also, we can't be tracking everybody all the time. So please let us know when you have a new email. Let us know, all right? Well, I'm not going on record on that one, so be proactive about sending us that information. Some of you probably know that we have something called a J term now, and a lot of the students come down here and shadow a working person here for the day. So if you have a great job, or even if you don't have a great job, suggest to the student come down and shadow that person for the day. You might have seen in the paper that the Big Harvard, as I call it, just kicked off a $6.5 billion capital campaign. Now we're going to be hearing, you're going to be hearing through emails and correspondence what Dean Elwood's plans are, priorities and things like that, but there are going to be ways to be certainly involved with the capital campaign. But I always have a little advertisement in that even a small check to the HKS fund is an important one. Because oftentimes big donors look and they ask for this very important percentage of alumni that have given to the fund. And that is a very valuable number when we're going after big gifts. So just a little one, please. The second last thing is, you know, when you're in Cambridge or in Boston, go to reunions, travel. When you come up, if you're going to be in the area, stop by the school. It's a very easy place to wander in and stay connected. So please, if you're in the area, make an effort. And then the last thing is that the DC network, which we're is hosting, part of the host for tonight, we're 9,000 people here, 9,000 alums in town. So there's lots of wonderful places to get connected. We have a great program. So I'm going to ask, there are a couple of my fellow board members tonight in attendance. I'm going to ask them to stand, as well as their number of members from the DC leadership of the DC network. And we have all these fancy little ribbons. So if everybody, there are a couple of you in the audience, I know, so stand up. Allison Shapiro runs the organization. So if you could kindly find us at the reception, we have lots of ideas on how to get involved. So I'm not going to make this any longer. There is a reception to the side, so I vote we adjourn. Thank you very much.